I would like to invite the first speaker, who's an honorary professor at Oxford Academic Union. I would like to welcome Prof. Sunaina Singh, the Vice Chancellor of Nalanda University in India, to start with the video about her university and then her speech. You are welcome, our honorary professor.
It's a huge privilege and honor to head Nalanda University as Vice Chancellor. And Nalanda was initiated by King Samudragupta in 4th century BC. It continued till around 12th century. After 8 centuries of its existence, it was destroyed by Bakhtiar Khilji, and thereafter, it took another 8 centuries of lull, of being in slumber, before we woke up to the reality that this university needs to be revived and re-established. And the credit here goes to the East Asian countries for taking the initiative and rethinking about Nalanda, acknowledging its historical prestige and its contribution to the world. The credit also goes hugely to our former president, APJ Abdul Kalam ji, who mooted the idea of re-establishing Nalanda University. How does a university in today's world emerge as an institution that instills value systems, that instills the ancient Indian knowledge tradition, wherein India was seen as a Vishwaguru? My endeavor, therefore, has been to create a completely net zero campus, a sustainable campus. Quite a challenging task to my mind, because it's not easy to create a campus that's completely net zero. Perhaps it will emerge as the world's largest campus, because our geographic space that has been allocated to Nalanda is about 500 acres, which is humongous by itself. Today we are a very small university because we are still developing in a new ethos that goes with the ancient knowledge tradition, and at the same time is very multipolar, futuristic, very international, very global in its courses. What can the Western world, the European world, learn from the Eastern traditions, the value systems, the spiritual ethos? That's one way of looking at it. We also have the Indo-Pacific region, Bay of Bengal's research center that also looks at a lot of new facets. The Common Archival Resource Center that we have planned will be a repository of all aspects of knowledge, all aspects of history, all aspects of how the world has emerged, and what needs to be preserved, what has been preserved. So we connect with the libraries and museums and the repository across the world. That's the endeavor. So in brief, it's not just the Indian knowledge system, which is so relevant in terms of the spiritual guidance that India seemed to be providing. This is one nation that has produced so many religions. And today, the most relevant of all these is Buddhism. And that's one course that's immensely popular with students from almost 24 countries currently. And I think here is the ethos that we need to spread, of peace and harmony, and how to build value systems, how to be resilient in times of crisis, I think the pandemic lessons have taught us many, many things, and as we move forward, I think the current dialogue that's happening is all about higher education and the pandemic lessons. I think humanity has taken a back seat. We suddenly realize, or we have woken up to the reality that we need to respect nature. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Anisha. I was waiting to give some highlights of how do we deal with pandemic and the future university. I think it's very important that we are looking at various aspects of pandemic and the higher education. So thank you, Professor Haditi, and I must congratulate and compliment all the previous speakers, the distinguished professors who were deliberating on different areas of future universities. The topic, I find it very interesting because it gives us a room for thought as to how do we plan a future university. So I don't have a written script or a presentation. So I'm going to speak from my insights and highlight some issues that needs to be looked at. Because if we are planning to evolve a new mandate or look at the world's future, in terms of the multipolar global environment that we have, it's necessary, it's important, it's significant that we evolve as a future university. So that point is very well taken by Oxford. Let me now look at the pandemic and what has happened over a period of time. So with the raging uncertainties and complexities, coronavirus has cut a deadly path across the world, you will all agree. Separating families, friends, workmates, colleagues, because we are working long distance in many, many institutions and corporate world, collapsing healthcare system, destroying economies across the globe. This would mean that as institutions and as donning the leadership role of institutions, I think we need to navigate on a daily basis from one decision to another. How do we do it in higher education system across the globe, where institutions have also become pan-global? We are no longer just restricted in our national identities. I think we have moved far beyond that. We have our students, over 70% of them are international and they come from all over. So it's very important that as leaders in higher education, we need to navigate afresh, almost on a day-to-day basis, the number of challenges that we tend to face. So how do we take quick decisions where we can wrestle with the challenges that emerge due to pandemic? I think it's important to look at how do we craft a better roadmap for ourselves. So does it require a remodeling of higher education or education per se? Remodeling of institutions as future institutions. I think it would be worth to call it reimagining future institutions, because given the number of challenges, it calls for a future institution that is completely research-based, which has a blended method of both teaching, a hybrid method as we have been dealing with past year or two. And also all virtual platforms need to come into existence. We cannot do without that. Now, this has its negatives because the physical mode is absent. And the students, where the quotient of empathy, the quotient of compassion, quotient of culture, all this comes from a classroom. The culture, the etiquette, the discipline, somewhere it gets, this is the challenge. We don't have the face-to-face classroom any longer, and it might be some time before we embark on that. So we need to innovate constantly as institutions. So from the opportunities that seem to emerge from the disruption, do we have self-sustaining workplaces? Do we have self-sustaining virtual platforms that can see us through the crisis? How do we get, or how do we continue to stay productive in times of crisis like the pandemic? I think this is something that most leaders in higher education look at, because the number of challenges, and you cannot satisfy everyone, because institutions mean coming together of administration, faculty, the non-teaching, the staff, the students, the health system that we can provide, the facilities. Not possible to keep everyone happy. So we need to pick and choose and navigate there. So we need to constantly wrestle to innovate and have the courage to move forward. You know, it's important that, as leaders, we be transformational leaders there. We also need to build a purposeful future for our students. How do we continue to do that is something that institutions need to take another look at. So it's a constant reinventing of the self. Bernard Shaw had said at one point of time that life isn't about finding yourself. Life is about creating yourself. I think this is cannot be more true, more applicable than the present times, where we need to constantly reinvent and recreate ourselves. You know, Charles Bukowski also echoed the same thing when he said, we need to invent and keep reinventing ourselves. So how do we do it at every level? As faculty, as administrators, as leaders. So we need to constantly craft a better way to deal with it. So let's look at, as institutional leaders, what could be the decision-making framework? You know, there has to be a decision-making framework. And that is where I thought we look at management of the first decision-making would be managing internal state. You know, what is it? How is the institution? How do we recreate it as a future institution? Towards that goal, we need to ask different questions as to how do we move forward. Get multiple perspectives on decision making. What could be the outcome is something that we need to look at, because institutions should be outcome based. Systematic intelligence and systematic innovation should also be built into the institutions, because without that, it's very difficult to move forward. Otherwise, one would be a college and not a university. This is where I thought stretching, testing ourselves, reshaping the ways we approach our decision making. For that, I think we need to have a go-to framework in front of us where we are constantly reinventing ourselves. So the frameworks have to be very firmly in front of us. And we look at different challenges during the pandemic time. And I was looking at what could be the challenges that we need to learn to live with in future, pandemic or no pandemic, because pandemic has taught us many valuable lessons. We have learned to live in these uncertain times with huge complexities, without knowing the future of our loved ones or our own. It's been a tough journey for everyone. So how do we create a new generation which is positive, productive? How do we shape the intellectual milestone per se where youngsters are concerned. So this is very important. So we need to first focus on what is the primary threat to education per se? What could be the primary threat? How do we charter our young students? How do we navigate through this? The second would probably be what may be coming next and what do we need to plan? You know, we also need to be ready for the newer challenges. So if anything happens, how do we look at it? So do we have a management mechanism in place? So that's another thing. And third and the most important, what are the resources that we have? Do we have a support system? Do we have resources for research built in, you know, in the institution? I think to my mind, these are very important tools of building a future university. Before I close, just to posit on what could be the leadership role here, you know, if a head of the institution or the deans in schools, you know, what do we expect? We expect a transformational leaders who will demonstrate specific behaviors or specific way of moving forward. And one could be, how can we inspire? How do we create role models for successful research, for future planning? You know, role models are very important. Inspiring youngsters or your faculty is very important. So that is inspirational motivation that we look at. Second would be intellectual stimulation, which allows for questioning the status quo. I think this is again very important. And thirdly, I think considerations of the academic framework, curricula and research framework. How do we look at the considerations of research for the next 10 years? You know, do we look at environment as a huge challenge? The climate sciences need to be looked at. Probably the vanishing jungles need to be, forests need to be addressed. Are we losing the ecology around us? Are we losing the forest area? Does that impact our health system? Or do we look at epidemiology afresh, where science and ecology is concerned, where liberal arts and social sciences are concerned? Where are the value systems? Do we, you know, collate, look at the best practices across the globe from different countries as to what would be the cultural enhancement? How do we build a new value system for our younger generation, which is more global? You know, how do we create new thought leaders? I think this is very important, and we need to posit on all this, and that's what would constitute a future university, to my mind. Thank you for giving me time. I think these were some of the insights that I wanted to share with my Oxford colleagues out here. Thank you, Professor Haditi, for giving me time. If there are any queries and Q&A, I'll be very happy.
Thanks a lot, Prof. Sunaina. We are always happy to have you with us more and more. And nice to see you again. Now I will let some of the participants, they have questions, you know, about this inspiring presentation. I will ask Prof. Banerjee to ask his question, please.
Thank you, sir. But my question was regarding the earlier session, sir. So I enjoyed the session lecture given by Professor Sunaina Singh, madam. But that question was posted earlier, sir. So you can take the questions from other participants.
Okay, then in this case, I will go to.
Actually, yeah. it was to Dr. Ahmed in the earlier session.
Okay, shall I go to Dr. Patel?
Sure, sir.
Downey Patel.
Good evening. Greetings, ma'am. I'm Dr. Dhwani from National Forensic Sciences University. I really enjoyed the motivational, inspirational speech that, ma'am, you have given us. Being an academician, apart from education, because we are talking about education in future, I would like to have some insights from you that how, ma'am, we can inspire our students to be in this pandemic, to have a mental being and trusting us on the education front. Because as such, as you know, ma'am, we have limited portion of time to teach them, educate them for any particular course. Because of this pandemic, we are trying our best to impart the education through virtual classes. But my question specifically involves the mental pressure the students are handling, which makes them realize that they're missing certain classroom education. How, as an academician, should we react to these type of situation?
Thank you. Thank you for that. That's a very nice question. And I would say that as a young faculty yourself, you know, it's important that we make our students enjoy their studies. So make it light, but tight, you know? So you have to give them the material, the resources, and snippets of it, you know? I find very lengthy, elaborate talks and documents that are sent to them in the blended mode. You know, as it is our students, they are also trying to deal with pandemic, you know, loss of friends, you're not able to get out of the home. There are a lot of psychological issues, and youngsters have more energy than anyone else, you know, so that energy needs to be unleashed. And that can be done through knowledge systems which are lighter, which also call forth for any new ideas. That you're inculcating a research sense also. Ask them if there are parallels in like this in music, whether they can find, you know, if we are talking about, for example, if you're talking about climate, supposing, or you're talking about medicine, maybe you can ask them as to what are the other alternate methods that grandparents used in their places, whether that is, can we think of it from a medical perspective? Would that be right? Does it have a clinical evidence? Does it have a laboratory, this thing? Or is it just a kind of, you know, small? Or maybe you can look at it, how do we lighten the burden? So we have to have different methods of dealing it, and not just be restrictive to an area that we are handling it. So we should learn to disengage them and engage with them. So it calls for remodeling, you know, it calls for remodeling, but the times are tough. And you cannot put pressure on students about their grades and evaluation and things like that. You know, ask them to write a term paper on their own idea of a utopian world. You know, how would they look at world? What is their idea of utopia or a better world? So it needs to be more creative rather than restrictive, to my mind. So we need to have new knowledge paradigms built.
Thank you very much for this answer, Prof. Sunaina. And I totally agree with you. And I suggest that Dr. Donnie Patel read about the micro learning, where you give the students what we call nuggets of information, because we are not in the information age anymore. We are in the digital age, and the student can have the information in the databases, in Google, and many places. So in order to engage him, think about the micro learning and give him the learning in bites. And I wish you all the good luck. And we are glad to have such a young and the new educators with us in this debate. You're welcome anytime. Now I will let Dr. Akansha to ask her question, please.
Hello, ma'am. Beautiful talk. I must admit that that whatever you talked about was in my mind throughout this debate. It is very important. As you said that, yes, it took us a pandemic to understand that less is more. It took us a pandemic to understand the importance of living in a community. It took us a pandemic to understand the relationships, and so it took us a pandemic to rediscover ourselves as individuals. We learned in some good universities, but we were not able to deal with the problem. What do you think? What kind of value system should be created and should be incorporated at in education system so that our children, our young generation, the coming generation, copes up with the problem in a better way than we did? Also, there is this common notion that value system is created during the formative years of a child when he or she is in school. Do you think, do you agree with that totally? If not, can we have an extension, or do you think that it is possible to mold student behavior and attitude even at the university level? Thank you so much, ma'am. This is my question.
Thank you, Akansha. Yes, I firmly believe that we learn. We need to constantly keep learning. We also need to constantly keep unlearning. If you want to relearn, you also need to unlearn some things which may not have added value to your life. So recrafting is very important. One doesn't just learn in childhood. That's the beginning of learning. So you're constantly evolving. So at a higher education level also, it's possible to evolve and build your value system. It depends on how the faculty and the students, a dynamic interaction, so I firmly believe that we all keep learning even at this stage. So state of learning should be on. Now the other important thing is there's so much to learn from sports. Sports teaches us to be competitive. It teaches us to take failure with equanimity. You know, take a look at sports. I think that's one value I think we have forgotten to speak about. We fail in a game, be it a cricket match or a football, but they come back for the next national or next state level. They're still preparing even after failure. They don't give up. The sportsmen are constantly at it to prepare. You know, we don't hear about depression there. We don't hear about failure impacting them. You know, they, for the next match, they are again at it. So I think it's very important that we learn that, you know, failure is a part of life. Life is not going to be an easy ride. You know, it's never perfect. So we need to learn to live with imperfections. Need to learn to live with failure. So what is necessary is the resilience that you draw. It's like a well within you. You never know how much you can draw. When you emerge out of a crisis, at times you wonder, oh, how did I survive that? I thought I'm going to give up. But you do. Because we draw from that inner reservoir, you know, of energy, of resilience. I think that needs to be, that inner reservoir should be always active. You know, we may be annoyed, unhappy, failed in something, but don't give up. Keep at it, because that's very important. That's another value that would help. So I find these days we give up very easily. You know, we are depressed easily. We are unhappy, and discontent seems to be looming large. I think this pandemic, as you rightly pointed out, has taught us many lessons. It has taught us to survive. You know, and we are thankful that life is still with us. you know, and our loved ones. So I think the art of being thankful, the gratitude is very important. Humility is very, so these are values that need to be, you don't have to learn only in childhood or in school. We constantly evolve this. So never forget anybody who has done you a good turn or helped you or held your hand even for a moment. That value system will take us a long, long way. And as far as Professor Aditi was pointing out on micro learning, you know, these days we talk about capsule programs. Yeah. You know, quick learning and how much can you get in a capsule form? So I think that also, gratitude is again a capsule form. It stays, it does well to our system.
Yes,
100%. I hope I have answered you well.
Thank you very much, Professor Sunaina. And the last question will go to Prof. Sonali. Prof. Sonali.
Hello, ma'am. I have a very simple question, a doubt also. If such financial constraints continue due to pandemic, is there any chance that students from ordinary family will be soon deprived from higher education to meet other challenges of life? Especially, my concern is about female students. Do you feel like me, or this is my irrelevant question? You can explain.
No, it's not at all irrelevant. It's a very good question. We are talking about minority, we are talking about gender, we are talking about the deprived sections of society who may not be able to. So this is a very relevant question. Given the financial constraints, I think it's very important that nations build support systems, you know, which I think a lot of countries already have that in their education system. And I think even India is doing very well. We have so many measures where gender is concerned, deprived sections are concerned. So I'm not disheartened. You know, the financial constraints we will have to deal with, given the economies not doing so well. You know, it might be a challenge. But I don't think government is going to pull back some of the schemes. I think secondly, we also need to look at what are the fellowships available anywhere, you know? So we need to be alert and be flexible in our choices. If I want something here and now and wherever I am in my comfort zone, may not be possible. You know, we need to be flexible in our thinking, in our approach, look for fellowships, do well, prove your merit. I think the world is always there to help those who seek out. So seekers are never at loss, you know. So I don't think we should be disheartened there.
Thank you very much, Prof. Sunaina, for the nice presentation and the encouraging answers. Thank you very much.
I look forward to you sometime.